Hello students, welcome to my lecture series on reinforced concrete structures. In this class, I am going to discuss about a complete design of cantilever slab by using a limit state method. This can be designed as per IS 456-2000 codal provisions. So you know what is a cantilever is. Cantilever beam or a cantilever slab means one end of the slab is fixed and another end of the slab is free. Then we can call it as a cantilever slab. So that this type of slab we have to design based on the recommendations given by IS 456-2000 as per limit state method. So let us see a typical image of a cantilever beam. Say, as I told you, the cantilever beam means the one end of the beam is fair. Cantilever slab means one end of the slab is fixed, another end is free. So if you observe this image, say this end is a fixed and this is a projection from the fixed support or fixed end. This projection nothing but a slab here. So that this end is fixed and this end, there is no support here at this end. So I can call it a free end support. There is no support means it is a free support or free end I can call it as. So that's why one end of this slab is fixed, another end of this slab is free. So this slab is termed as a cantilever slab. And you can see in this direction also, in this direction, see here the slab is fixed, another direction, this direction the slab is free from the support. So in this direction also we can call it as a cantilever slab. So generally this can be the cantilever type of slabs, or generally we can see chajjas or balkhanis, there we provide a cantilever slab. So let us discuss what are the outcomes of today's class is. So after completion of this class, you will be able to design by your own one-way cantilever slab is based on what are the steps we have discussed for a design of a one-way slab. Based on those steps, we have to design what is a one-way cantilever slab is. And let us recall the points what we discussed in last class. In last class, we have discussed about a complete design of simply supported one-way slabs. So you know the simply supported means when the slab is supported by two parallel walls, and when the slab is placing over that, then I can call it as a simply supported slab, right? When you provide a reinforcement in only one direction, that is a shorter direction, then I can call it as a one-way slab. So that is simply supported and one-way slab we have designed in previous class based on the design steps what we discussed in previous classes. Say, let me recall again those steps. So in first step we have decided is to calculate the effective depth. This effective depth can be calculated based on the deflection control criteria. Based on that we have calculated for simply supported beam, this ratio will varies from that L by D ratio should varies from 25 to 30. From that we have to calculate what is the effective depth is. And then we have calculated effective length. Effective length can be calculated based on the two criteria, you know, that is one is center to center distance between support, and another is the clear spans plus effective depth. The minimum of these two criteria, the minimum value of these three criteria will be taken as a effective span of the simply supported one-way slab. Then we have to design, or we have to calculate what are the design loads are. Design loads are nothing but a combination of dead load, live load, or any finishes, floor finishes are there. Those load also we have to add. For adding all together, we have to calculate total load. Then we have to, if you multiply it with some partial factor of safety, then we will be getting design of our factored design load. After calculating factored design load, you go for calculation of factored bending moment or maximum bending moment which is likely to occur on the slab. After calculating this factored bending moment, then we have to equate that factored bending moment to the limiting moment of resistance for calculating minimum effective depth required. From this equation, that is the maximum bending moment equal to the limiting moment of resistance equation, we can calculate what the small d is. Small d is here effective limiting depth required for given loads. So that if that obtained minimum depth required is less than our assumed are already what we calculated in the first step, then that assumed value will be treated as a actual depth for the slab design. Then after that we have to calculate what the area of steel, that is AST,
from caudal equations, or we can calculate with respect to the moment of resistance formula in tension zone. That is mu equal to 0.87 fy ast d into 1 minus fy ast by fck into bd formula. From this formula, we can calculate what is the ast is. So these are the design of your simply supported one way slab. After designing this, we have to go for check of this slab. So again, we have to check again as the minimum reinforcement, we have to check again as the deflection, we have to check it again as the development length. These are the things we have done with your simply supported one way slab in your previous class. So let us start today's class. We'll design a cantilever slab. This is also called a chajja or balkan. So here are some additional features, or I can say additional points to be remember while designing the cantilever slab or chajja. So here, while designing a cantilever slab, one way cantilever slab or a chajja is designed as a cantilever beam of 1 meter width. It is as similar to as design of a cantilever beam, but a slab width we have more than the width of the slab. But for our design of slab, we have to consider it at a 1 meter width of the beam, and we start designing the one way cantilever beam. And these are the points we have to remember while designing the cantilever slab or chajja. The effective length of the slab is equal to the unsupported or projecting length of the slab. That means, so the effective length for calculation is somewhat different from your simply supported slab. Here the effective length can be treated as what is the unsupported length, or I can say projected length. What do you mean by projected length? The length which is projected from the fixed end, that length is called a projected length. So that length we can consider as a effective length for designing one way cantilever slab. And then we have effective depth at fixed end is maximum considered as a span by 10 to the span by 12. So we can design this cantilever slab into, or a cantilever beam, in two different ways. One is we can design a uniform depth with a uniform depth, or we can design it a varying depth. So the maximum depth of a fixed end, when you are designing the slab, depth at a fixed end, maximum should be considered between the values span by 10 to the span by 12. And then we have one more point, at the free end, if you are designing a varying depth slab or varying depth beam, that means the depth at the fixed support is different from depth at free support, free end. So that the free end will be at the free end, we have to keep the thickness is 1/2 to the 1/3 of depth at a fixed end. Suppose you are considering depth at fixed end 100 mm, the depth at the depth of slab at fixed end. Then if you at the free end, thickness of the slab at free end is 1/2, that is 1/2 to the 1/3. Say 100 means 1/2 of 100 equal to 50 mm, that we have to provide at the free end. And the main reinforcement is provided at the top, and it is to be cut at the appropriate point. You know, the nature of a cantilever beam is, or a cantilever slab is. So when you apply a load on a cantilever beam or a slab, the topmost fiber of the slab are subjected to tension, and bottommost fibers are subjected to compression. As our concrete is very weak in tension, so we have to provide reinforcement in the tension zone. So unlike your simply supported slab, your simply supported slab, if you apply a load over that, then the topmost fibers are subjected to compression and bottommost fibers are subjected to compression. Whereas in cantilever, it is different. So that's why we have to provide the main reinforcement in a tension or tension zone or a top of the slab. And your one way simply supported slab, we have provided your main reinforcement along the shorter direction, the bottom of the slab. That means it is a common, there is a tension zone. That in simply supported condition, tension zone occurs below the neutral axis and compression zone occurs above the neutral axis. As is the case with a cantilever slab, the tension zone occurs above the neutral axis and compression zone occurs below the neutral axis. These we have discussed in detail about when you are discussing about types of beam section, that is a singly reinforced beam, doubly reinforced beam. When you discuss there we have discussed this, right? So with these additional criteria, we have to design the cantilever slab now. So here the problem is The design a cantilever slab for a overhang of 1.25 meters. The superimposed load on the slab consists of 1 kN per meter square and weight of finishing is 800 Newton per mm square. Use M20 grade concrete and Fe415 steel. So if you observe the problem here, the superimposed load given in kilonewton per meter square and weight of the finish or finishing course, I can say that is 800 Newton per meter square. So don't confuse directly. If you use this value, means your problems is going to wrong. Your design will be going to wrong. It is in kilonewton per meter square and it is Newton per meter square. You should convert this imposed load in terms of Newton per meter square and then only calculate the total load. Alright, let me know what are the inputs, means what are the given data is. So design the cantilever slab for a overhang of 1.25 meters. See, what do you mean by overhang? What is the definition of overhang? At this point you might have studied in your strength of material subject when you are discussing about overhanging beams. Overhang means, the meaning of overhang means the length of the beam extended beyond the support. The length of the beam extended beyond the support. Other words, I can say the length of the beam projecting after the support. So I can say the design cantilever slab of overhang of 1.25 meter means it is a effective length of the cantilever slab. So how to calculate effective length of the cantilever slab? It is a projecting length from the support. Similarly, the overhang means it is a projecting length from the support. So the effective length of the slab equal to 1.25 meters. And what are the type of loads are given? Imposed load, or I can say live load, that is 1 kilonewton per meter square. And apart from this imposed load, one more load given, that is weight of finishes, that is 800 Newton per meter square. And grade of concrete given is M20, that is the characteristic compressive strength of a concrete, FCK equal to 20 Newton per mm square. And yield strength of a steel, that is Fy equal to 415 Newton per mm square. So in this, here we have to convert this also. Live load equal to 1 kilonewton per meter square means it is 1000 newton per meter square, that we have to convert in terms of newtons, as weight of the finishes is in newton per mm square. Clear? So with this input data we have to design a one way cantilever slab. In the first step is calculation of effective depth of the slab or thickness of slab, as this can be calculated based on the recommendation given by IS 456 2000. That is, we have discussed the additional feature called what is the effective depth of a cantilever beam slab and how to calculate the effective span of a cantilever slab and effective depth of a cantilever slab. According to those recommendation, the effective depth based on the stiffness criteria or the deflection criteria can be taken as span by 10 to the span by 12. For this problem, I am taking effective depth equal to span by 10. Right, so we can take between this value or this value, or in between this value also we can take. But in this problem, I am taking the span by 10th for my calculation of effective depth for a one-way cantilever slab. The span is already known to you, that is 1.25 meter, that is converted into mm, then we will get 1250 mm, and that is a span, and by 10, the effective depth of the slab will be give me, that is 125 mm. So I am designing here a uniform depth slab. A uniform depth slab I am designing here. So that's why throughout the length of the slab, the depth remains same. And adopt a clear cover 20 mm and using, say here, I am using 8 mm bars. Right. I am using 8 mm bar here. So you please correct it. Use 8 mm bar, it is not a 10 mm, it is a 8 mm bar. For that, you may get the total depth will be 125 plus 20 plus, it is 8 by 4, approximately we get 149, so that is equal to the 150 mm is the overall depth. So next, calculate the total load, from that we have to calculate what the design load is. As I told you, we have to design our cantilever slab by considering 1 meter width of the slab. So based on that, we have to calculate dead load. Dead load nothing but overall depth multiplied by 1 multiplied by 1 multiplied by unit weight of the RCC. It is 1 meter width and 1 meter length of the slab. So it is 1, 1. So overall depth is 150 mm, that will convert into meter 0.15, and multiplied by this unit weight of concrete is 25,000 newton per meter cube, and finally if you multiply we'll get 3750 newton per meter square. And we got live load is 1 kilonewton per meter square. If we convert this kilonewton into newtons, then this will be 1000 newton per meter square. And also given finishes, that is 800 newton per meter square. And if we add together, that is dead load plus live load for finished load, we'll get that 3750 is dead load, live load is 1000, finishes is 800. Altogether we'll get 5550 newton per meter square. This is just load which is coming onto the slab. We have to calculate what the design load is. On what load we have to design the sections of the slab. That load we have to calculate now. That the design load can be, or factor load can be calculated by multiplying the total load with a suitable partial factor of safety. Generally the partial factor of safety will consider as 1.5 meters into total load. That is 1.5 into 5550 kilonewton per meter square. And that factor load will be 8325 newton per meter square. So for this load we have to design all the parameters of the slab. So after calculating the factor load, we have to calculate design moment or factored moment. As we are designing a cantilever slab, as it is similar to your cantilever beam, we know from your strength of material topic, that is shear force and bending moment, when a cantilever beam with a uniformly distributed load, then the maximum bending moment occurs at the free end, that is WL square by 2, that equal to what? The bending moment at fixed end, that is WL square by 2, that is here we are using W equal to factor load W, L square by 2 will become the design moment. And we have calculated what is already W is 8325 into 1.25 square by 2, will get ME equal to 6504 newton into meter. If we convert this into a newton into mm, then you have to multiply with that is 6.50 to the power 6 newton into mm we get. So after calculating that, we have to calculate whether the adapted depth is adequate or not. We have to check it. So for that we have to calculate what is the minimum effective depth required. What is the minimum effective depth required for applied load and applied bending moment, that we have to check. So this can be calculated by using equating the maximum bending moment to the limiting moment of resistance of the section, that is mu equal to mu limit. We know the mu limit is k into fck bd square. This k value depends upon the grade of steel. If you are using fe 250, the k value will be 0.148, fe 415, that is 0.138, and fe 500, that is 0.133. and right from that, if you substitute the all those values in this equation, you will get the d equal to, already we have calculated what is mu is, that is 6.504 into 10 power 6 by 0.138, for it is corresponding to the value of Fe415, as we are using in this design of cantilever one way slab, where grade of concrete used is 415 and grade of concrete is 20, and we are considering 1 meter width of the slab, so that is 1000. So if we calculate this, we will get 49 mm, right? So the minimum depth required or sufficient depth is 49, but our adapted depth is 125, so that is more than the minimum depth required. So we can adapt. 125 mm is our actual depth of the slab, and by using these we go for further steps. Next, we have to calculate area of steel by considering 1 meter width of the slab. So this can be calculating by using moment of resistance formula corresponding to the tension or tension steel. That is mu equal to 0.87 Fy AST D into 1 minus Fy AST by FCK into BD. You know what is Fy value is? AST we have to calculate. D is the effective depth of the slab, and Fy is the grade of steel, and FCK is the grade of concrete or characteristic strength of a concrete. B is a 1 meter width of the slab, and D is the effective depth of the slab. If you substitute all those parameters in this equation, say mu is 6.504 into 10 power 6, that we already calculated, and 0.87 Fy is the 415, AST we have to calculate, D equal to 125, and 1 minus Fy is 415, AST we have to calculate, and whole by FCK is 20 and B is 1000 and small d is 125, then we will get a one quadratic equation, that is AST square minus 6025.5 into AST minus 8683.87.8. If you solve this equation, you will get area of steel AST is equal to 148 mm². Okay, so this is the AST provided actually, AST 148 mm². Now we have to check whether this obtained area of steel is sufficient or not. That we have to check with some codal provision. What is the minimum area of steel we can provide in slab? So for that we have a check for minimum reinforcement. If you are using Fe415, the minimum reinforcement will be 0.2% of whole cross-sectional area. Whole cross-sectional area, that is, see here, as we are using this Fe415, 0.12 by 100, 1000. So this is, please make it, it is a 150 we are using. The overall depth of the slab is 150. If you calculate that, we will get AST minimum will be 180 mm². How much we are getting? 180 mm². But the obtained AST is just 148 mm². As per it is not fulfilling the codal requirement. So code also says that whenever you get the AST minimum is greater than AST obtained, then minimum value of the steel considered as area of steel provided in the slab. So we have to provide AST equal to AST minimum. That means AST treated as AST minimum here. That is AST now hereafter. What is that? 180 mm². And using say 8 mm, it is not a 10 mm, please make it correct. 8 mm diameter bar, spacing is, we can calculate S equal to small AST by capital AST into 1000. So AST equal to area of 18 mm bar, that is pi by 4 8 square, 50.3 mm². So based on this we can calculate what the spacing is. So S equal to small AST is 50.3 and capital AST is 180, and this can be multiplied with 1 meter width of the slab, that is 1000 mm. So we get 279 mm. So as per IS 456-2000, spacing of main steel should not be more than this value. So whether the obtained spacing is following or the fulfilling these criteria or not, we have to check. So first criteria is 3 into D, the 3 into the effective depth of the slab. The effective depth is 120, 3 into 120, say it is 360 mm, and another is 300 mm, whichever is less we have to consider. But the obtained value is lesser than these two criteria, so this value we can take it as a obtained value, we can take it as a spacing for the main reinforcement provided in a cantilever slab, that is 279 mm. So we can round it out to 270 mm, hence provide 8 mm bars. It is not a 10 mm, it is a some copy type of topographical mistake. So 8 mm bars at 270 mm center to center, right? Then we have to calculate distribution reinforcement. So you know the distribution reinforcement is provided along the longer direction of a slab. For that also the minimum Fe to if a minimum reinforcement provided is 12% of gross cross section, 0.12% of gross cross sectional area. From this we can calculate 0.12 by 100. Is 1000 into 150 the overall depth. So AST minimum equal to 180 mm². For this I am using 6 mm diameter of bars as a distribution steel. Now we have to calculate spacing. As is well, the spacing can be calculated by using this formula, that is small AST by capital AST into 1000. A small AST is, it is area of 1 6 mm bar. It is not 8 mm, 1 6 mm bar. So from this I can calculate AST equal to pi by 4 into 6 square equal to 28.26 mm². After obtaining capital AST, you know, and small AST, you have calculated. Now we have to calculate what the spacing is. So S equal to small AST by capital AST whole multiplied by 1000, will get small AST equal to 28.26, capital AST is 180, and whole multiplied by 1 meter width of the slab, that is 1000 mm, will get spacing is 157 mm. Again, this obtained spacing, whether it is fulfilled the criteria of IS 456-2000, that we have to check. So what is the condition given with respect to the spacing of distribution bar in IS 456? That is, one criteria, first criteria is 5D, another is 450 mm, whichever is the less we have to provide. So if we calculated 5D, that is 5 into 120, that is 600 mm, and 450 and another criteria, the minimum of these two we have to calculate, consider as a spacing, but obtained value is less than these two codal recommendations. So anyhow we have to provide minimum value, so spacing will be provided 157 mm square, so mm, and we can round it to the round figure, that is spacing can be provided 150 mm center to center. So hence provide, it is a 6 mm bars, it is not a 8 mm bar, 6 mm bars at 150 mm center to center. Clear? Now we have calculated spacing for main reinforcement and spacing for distribution reinforcement per 1 meter width of the slab. And those things were checked against the IS 456-2000 codal recommendation. The hence we have satisfied all those things, and we are finally conclude that spacing for main reinforcement should be provided, that is 270 mm center to center. The diameter of bar used there is 8 mm. Whereas for distribution reinforcement, the spacing will be provided, that is 150 mm center to center. The diameter of bar used is 6 mm. Okay, clear. Next, after designing all those things, so we have designing means designing of a width, breadth, depth and area of steel provided. And those things we have to check with respect to the codal recommendation, whether the design parameters are safe against the following conditions, say deflection, development length and shear. Those things we have to check now. So let me check first, check for a deflection. So for checking the slab against the deflection, we should know what is the percentage of steel provided and what is the FS, that is stress under the service load in the steel. So let me calculate first what is the AST, that is percentage of steel is. So generally percentage of steel can be calculated 100 AST provided by B into D, but AST provided can be calculated by using this formula, that is 1 meter for the, we are calculating 1 meter width of the slab, multiplying area of one bar, one main reinforcing bar, by spacing provided. So 1000 is a 1 meter width of the slab, AST is a 18 mm diameter, as we are using 8 mm as a for the main reinforcement. The area of that 18 mm diameter bar is 50.3, and spacing provided for main reinforcement is 270. If we calculate, we will get 186.29 mm square. This is your, but this is your actual area provided in the slab. From this we have to calculate what is the AST, percentage of steel. This can be calculated 100, AST provided 186.29 by B into D. B is a 1 meter width and D is a 125 effective depth of a slab. From that we can calculate what is the percentage of steel is 0.15%. That is how much? 0.15%. By knowing this, after that we have to calculate stress in steel under the service load, FS. FS equal to 0.58 Fy into AST required by AST provided. You know already AST required is 180 mm, AST provided is 186.3. So if you substitute all those values in this formula, we will get, that is 0.58 into 415 multiplied by AST required is 180, AST provided is 186.3. Altogether we will get FS equal to 233 Newton per mm square. After knowing percentage of steel provided and the stress in steel under the service load, we have to calculate what is the modification factor is. From the modification factor, we have to calculate the deflection check. We have to know whether the slab is whether safe in deflection or not. So from obtained FS and PT, that FS means service load and in steel, PT is the percentage of steel provided, we can calculate modification factor by using this graph. On this graph, we have a x-axis percentage of steel tension reinforcement, and y-axis we have a modification factor. In between, we have a cos of FS, right? While after knowing that percentage of steel, that is 0.15. So there is no exact value here. So we have this 0.4 here, 0.2. Approximately the value of 0.15 is here. I am pointing out with a cursor. See this value, assume that this value. And what is that FS? FS is 233. So 233 remains between 190 and 240. So I am projecting. So this is somewhere my value will be remains. The curve will be remains here. Here, if I project that value onto these, it will touches. It will touches to the factor of safety 2. So I am considering that modification factor 2 for this condition. So L by D, from that, after knowing FS, PT and a modification factor, we have to calculate L by D max. L by D max equal to basic value into modification factor. For cantilever slabs, the basic value will be 7 and a modification factor is 2. So 7 into 2 is 14. And L by D provided is, the L is 1250 and D is 125. That will be 10. So L by D max is greater than L by D provided. So we can say that our slab is safe against the deflection. Hence, the slab is checked against the deflection. Then we have one more check, that is check against the shear. Generally slabs are safe in shear and development length, but anyhow we have to check. So next step would be determine the ultimate shear force using support conditions and type of loading. So as we are using, this is cantilever beam, it is a simply supported beam, cantilever beam subjected to UDL throughout, then we will get the maximum shear force at the supports. So please students, make it correct, it is a cantilever support or cantilever beam, it is not a simply supported beam. So the maximum shear force occurs at the support, that is V equal to W into L. So we know W is 8325 and L is 1.25, so we will get 10406.25 newtons. So from this we can calculate what is the nominal shear stress is. So nominal shear stress can be calculated at VU by BD. VU value we have already calculated, that is 10406.25 newtons, by B is 1000 and D is 125. From that we can get tau V equal to 0.08 newton for mm square. After obtaining these values, so we have to check whether it is safe against the shear or not. So we have to check two conditions. The first condition is, if tau V is less than tau C max by 2, then we can say our beam is, your slab is safe against the shear. And one more condition we have to check is, tau V should be less than or equal to K into tau C. Here tau C is a design shear strength and K is some factor for calculating a design shear strength for solid slabs. So we have to check those condition and we can make sure our slab is safe against the shear or not. So the first condition we have to check, for checking that we have to calculate maximum shear stress, that is the tau C max. This tau C max value will depend upon the grade of concrete. This can be obtained from the table number 20 of IS 456-2000, as given grade of concrete is M20, so the tau C max value will be 2.8 newton for mm square. Clear? From this we have to check. So tau C is, so tau V, nominal shear stress is 0.08 newton for mm square and tau C max is 2.8, but we have to check tau C max by 2, then 2.8 by 2, that is 2.8 by 2 equal to 1.4. From this it is clear that our tau V is less than half of tau C max. So hence we can say our slab is safe against the shear. Along with this we have to check one more condition also, that calculation of design shear strength. So before checking that we have to calculate what is the amount of design shear strength. So for calculating this we should know what is the percentage of steel, as we already calculated that the percentage of steel can be calculated by using this PT equal to 100 AST provided by BD, but AST provided can be calculated 1000 small AST by spacing. So 1000 is the width of the slab, 1 meter width of the slab, AST is the area of 1 80mm diameter bar, that is 50.3, and spacing provided is 270. Altogether we will get 186.3 meters 3mm square. From that we can calculate PT, that is 100 into 186.3 by B is 1000 and D is 125. So PT equal to 0.15%. So to find the tau c value from the table number 19 of IS 456-2000, we have to take the values from percentage of steel, that is 0.15%, and grade of concrete is M20. From that, the value obtained is, say, for M20, it is less than or equal to, you can consider, and so the 15. So the tau c value obtained is 0.28 newton per mm square. This is the percentage of steel and this is the grade of concrete. The corresponding value will be 0.28 newton per mm square. Clear? So after knowing that value, we have to go for condition. The condition has to satisfy is our nominal shear stress is less than or equal to K into tau c. The K value is depends upon the overall depth of the slab. Here the K value for different depth of the slab is given. But our depth of the slab provided is overall depth of the slab is 150 mm. So it is correct it 150 mm, and for that the K value will be 1.3. If we calculate what is the design shear strength value for a flat slab, that is 1.3 into 0.28, we'll get 0.36 newton per mm square. If you check that, I have to satisfy this condition, that is tau v less than k times tau c. So tau v is, you know, 0.08 newton per mm square, and k times tau c is 0.364. So from this values you can clearly knows that our tau v is less than k times tau c. Hence we can say our slab is safe against the shear. So then we have to calculate development length, that is development length is equal to the minimum length that should be embedded in the support. That length we have to calculate by using this formula 0.87 fy 5 by 4 tau bd. 0.85 is 415. Diameter of bar used is, say here, your 8 mm, we are using, please correct it, 8 mm. Then we get around 450 or 460 mm, but we have to provide the 450 or 460 mm is little bit in higher side, so we have to reduce that value. So provide LD equal to 400 mm, right? Then this is the reinforcement detailing. Now what are the things we are design? Those things are placed here in the cross section. Say assume that it is a support, fixed support. The width of the support is 300 mm, and we know the effective length of this cantilever slab is the length which is overhanging portion. The portion of overhanging is from its face of the support is n, so that is 1.25 meter. The same thing we have taken for our effective length of the beam, and see, and the overall depth of the slab is 150 mm, and we have to provide this black color line will show you main reinforcement. If you observe this main reinforcement is provided in tension zone, that is top of the beam, in the topper side of the beam. So this is the neutral axis, say the above the neutral axis we have a tension zone, and below the neutral axis we have compression zone in corresponding to your cantilever slab. That's why we are provided our main reinforcement in tension side. So what is the diameter bar used? 8 mm bar, and we are providing 270 mm center to center for the spacing for this main reinforcement. And these dots are shown you that the distribution reinforcement, those are provided below the main reinforcement. See, the diameter of bar used is 6 mm, and they are placed at 150 mm center to center. Right? Next, we have calculated development length. The total development length we have obtained is some 450 or 460, but it is possible to provide here it up to 400 only. So here in the support it is embedded is 280. And for the anchorage, we have made anchorage in terms of 90 degrees bend. So that 90 degrees bend length will be 120. So if we add all together, we'll get 400 mm. So these are the design features and a cross section or reinforcing detail of a one-way cantilever slab. Right, these are the concept we have discussed today, or we have designed a one-way cantilever slab. So based on that, we have some quiz questions. So let me see the first question. For a cantilever slab, the span to depth ratio as per control of deflection is, generally this value is varies from a span per 10 to the span per 12, but let's see what value is given in option. Option A is 20 mm, option B is 12, option C is 30, and option D is 25. But generally value varies from 10 to 12, but where we have the 12 value is there, that value we consider as a answer for this question. So for control of deflection, L by D ratio consider is a 12. Right? The next question is, the center to center distance of main bars and slab shall not be exceed. So this is again code of recommendation. For any slab, it is a simply supported slab or a cantilever slab or a continuous slab, there is a codal recommendation given by IS 456-2000. There are two conditions. If the main reinforcement, the spacing should be 3 times effective depth or 300 mm, whichever is less. So that value you have to provide as a spacing for the main reinforcement. Let us see what value is given. Option A is 200 mm, option B is 300 mm, option C is 400, option D is 500, but the value matches is 300 mm. We can provide a spacing for the main reinforcement. So option B is correct. And one more question we have. So this question is, the center to center distance of a distribution bar, so it is not a main bar, please correct it. The center to center distance of distribution bar in slab shall not exceed is. Again, we have a subcodal recommendation for IS 456-2000 that is given that. So our first criteria is 5D and second criteria is 450 mm, whichever is the less, that will be provided as a spacing for the distribution reinforcement. Dear student, please correct this question. The center to center distance of a distribution bars in slab shall not be exceed, that is 450 mm, that is as per codal recommendation. So this is all for today's lecture. Thank you. And before going concluding my topic, let me summarize the steps what we discussed today for a design of your one-way cantilever slabs. So first we have calculated what is the design effective depth is, that is based on the stiffness criteria. For this we can choose the L by 10 to L by 12 for calculating effective depth in this with respect to this cantilever slab. Then we have to calculate effective length. Generally effective length will be considered as a overhanging portion of the slab, that will be considered as a effective depth. Then we have to calculate total load or factor load, that is dead load plus live load for finishes. That value must be multiplied with the partial factor of safety, that is 1.5. From that we will get what is the total factor load is. From the factor load we have to calculate what is the factored bending moment, that is WL square by 2 with respect to the cantilever slab. And after calculating the factor load or factor bending moment, that value must be equal to the limiting moment of resistance. From that we can calculate what is the minimum effective depth required for the slab, and those obtained minimum depth required for the slab will be compared with the calculated effective depth. If the calculated effective depth is more than that minimum depth required, then we can adapt what is the obtained value, that is calculated value of effective depth for as a original or actual effective depth for the slab. Then we have to calculate area of steel, that we can calculate as per our IS 456-2000 equation, that is ME equal to 0.87 FY AST into D into 1 minus FY AST by FCK BD formula. From that AST we have to calculate. After calculating AST we have to check again is the minimum reinforcement provided, that is depend of minimum reinforcement provided based on the grade of steel, that is it one for Fe250, that is different percentage we have for Fe2415, that is a different percentage we have. Those values you have to check with respect to the codal conditions, then go for check again as the deflection, check in the development length, and check again as the shear. So thank you, that's all for today's class.